termites. What is going on? It's episode 19. Can you believe that? We're getting very popular. At least so says the people in charge of that. I don't know who that is. The people that would be in charge. And we like to open the show with the Dolly quote. So one time I didn't do it and everybody got so mad. This is on dieting. Dolly said, every single diet I ever fell off of was because of potatoes and gravy of some sort. Well, I couldn't agree more. That's probably my favorite thing on the whole planet. Mashed potatoes would have to be part of my last meal if I was going to the electric chair. I don't know what else would be there, but it would definitely be mashed potatoes. So, what are we drinking? Bloody Mary, beer back. But what is the vodka? Now, this is an exception I made. Mainly, this is the last show. I bought this in Boise, Idaho, which was the last live show I did in 2020. And I joked that it would be the last show of 2020, not thinking it would be. And it was. But look, I bought it because that looks like a jackalope. Mm-hmm. Doesn't it? This is potato vodka from the Grand Teton. From the base of the Grand Teton. If you had to believe that. Born and bred, batch made, damn smooth craft potato vodka. Now, here's the weird thing. I had sworn off potato vodka because one time in Afghanistan, on a USO deal, there was no alcohol allowed. Well, somehow Kid Rock had some. And he was sweet and he shared it, but he didn't bring a lot. I didn't know you could. I thought somebody would yell at us. I don't know. I just figured it doesn't seem like a real drinking country, you know? But somehow Kellie came in with a white bottle of liquor and goes, I found some vodka.
Kellie who?
Kellie Pickler. Sorry, Paddles. Kellie Pickler, the country singer lady. She's a lot of fun. And she's in Hallmark movies now. So if Kellie happens to be listening, shout out. That was a cute little movie. Anyway, and I took a drink of it, whatever was in that bottle, a shot of it, because I hadn't had alcohol in probably, seemed like 7 years. It was probably 13 days. And I swallowed it, but it was I've never said no to alcohol, especially when not given alcohol for 2 weeks. There's no way I'm going to say no to any drink usually, but that, and she said, I don't know, they told me it was some sort of potato vodka. And I went, okay, well, I'm good. No, thank you. I'll drink water. And for me to say that, so that's why I swore off potato vodka. But I'm not even sure that was potato vodka. Kellie could have just been told that, or maybe Kellie thought that. I don't know, beggars can't be choosy when you're in that kind of situation. Moving on to what? Our gas station or bad or junk or fattening food, whatever. I like to call this segment gas station food, but then there's people out there. Most of the fans are very fun and smart. Some of you guys are sending me articles. Eventually, I won't even have to do anything. You'll find the weird stuff for me, and then I regurgitate it. But I like gas station food, although I know some of these things are not sold at a gas station. I am clear on that. I've probably been in more gas stations, at least as many, as a trucker. So you guys want to keep challenging me on that? Or you want to lay down swords? I suggest you lay down swords on that. Let's start with this, because this got me very excited. This is holiday stuff. Rice Krispies, look at this. They colored them in holiday colors. Now, if you're a good Midwest person, you will take these Rice Krispies, pour them in a bowl, and then pour 4 cups of sugar on it. And that's how Rice Krispies are delicious, which is why I haven't had them since I was probably 10. But I'm going to eat these. And then these I'm going to give to my mom.
Rice Krispie squares, too.
Rice Krispie squares, I don't like those. I only like to see. I always was disappointed when somebody's mom would make those in grade school and say she was like the treat lady for after the game.
Yeah.
Bleh.
Delicious.
Boo.
So good.
Mini crullers from Krispy Kreme sold in a box. Funny story about Krispy Kreme. I believed in fat people in America. Chubby termites, I believed in you. And I bought stock in this a long time ago. I don't know anything about stock, really. I just like to buy stock in stuff I see on the road that I think is going to get popular. And I think I bought it like $20 a share, and it got up to $49. And my brother told me, stop being a greedy pig and sell your stock. And I said, no, I wanted to get to 50. Then it went down to like 12. I didn't make it. I got greedy. He was right. He was right. My Bitcoin's doing good. We're going to talk about more about that next week, though, because that's a little hard. And I don't think Paddles is in the mood for hard. No. No. Paddles doesn't want to learn.
No, it's Christmas.
Well, it is. It's Christmas. Right. So that's what you could get. Get your Rice Krispies with holiday colors. Oh, look. On the back, they teach you how to do all the... You can start with favorite. Oh, yeah. You can make the Rice Krispie puff things into things. Like stars and candy canes. Cool. No, I hated the moms who brought that. And in a Catholic school, there wasn't really a cafeteria. You just had to deal with what you were given. The best thing about a Catholic school was, though, one Friday of the month, the Italian moms would make lunch. And it was fucking gangbusters. Because we were all like, I was like, shit, why didn't we get an Italian mom? Their food, their spaghetti was so good. But that was only once a month you got hot food. That was it. We didn't have a cafeteria. It was a shitty Catholic grade school. Well, maybe they had a cafeteria. I don't know. We weren't. I don't know. I was just took a lunch. Maybe my mom and dad just didn't have any money. That's possible. Moving on, we have a lot of updates, termites. And I thought I'd share that, starting with Dolly, because a lot has gone on with this queen. These queens, Stevie, very quiet. I think she's sad because she can't sing. She can't go on the road. She's kind of pouting. Cher is very tired because she came all the way back from Cambodia to make sure that elephant was all right and not lonely and sad. Which, you know what? That's why I have four queens. Everybody's doing something different. And Tanya over here, that's why she's carrying the beer. Good, she's a good time, Charlie. She hasn't been, I check her social medias and all that. Not a lot going on. Speaking of social media, if you'd like a fun new account to follow, well, first of all, you should go to my Twitter account and look at the video I posted of Jackie Cation, who's another Midwestie comic, who I think is makes me laugh hard out loud. She posted a video, which I retweeted, about snowmobiling in Minnesota. And it's a 1 minute clip, and I laughed 5 times out loud. It's just nails it. And only Jackie is the only person I know that would shoot Rumple Mints, because I won't. It's 100 proof. Maybe one shot. But Jackie would do.
Chilled.
What?
You gotta chill it.
Yeah.
Or you'll vomit.
Right. But you get to a certain point, you won't even know if you're vomiting.
True.
Tanya, she... But so anyway, go to my Twitter account and watch that video for fun if you want a fun... funny joke there from Jackie, and then you should go see go look at the rest of Jackie's stuff. She's very, very funny, and sometimes I would say, and I don't want this to offend her, but I think underrated sometimes. Not enough people, in my opinion, know about Jackie, even though a shitload do. I think it could be more. That's how I'm putting that, because I mean it. If you'd like a funny Twitter account to follow, guess who just joined Twitter? Dionne Warwick.
What?
Young people say, who that? Who that? Do you know the way to San Jose? I'm gonna get you there. Yeah, Dionne just turned 80 years old, and she looks 38, looking great. And she joined Twitter because her niece showed her how. And she's very funny in a certain way. She's really pissed off at these people with weird names like The Weeknd. She's like, it's not even spelled right. And why do you have the, okay, I'm the Dionne Warwick. She gets very sassy. It's a fun, it's not hilarious, but it's a fun account to follow for something new and silly on Twitter. All right. The Grand Teton. I just took a drink of that Bloody Mary. All right. Dolly Parton shares her morning routine, including the breakfast she cooks for her husband. You want a Dolly Parton cookbook? You can have it. But do you have $250? That's how few are left in circulation, and that's how much they cost. It's called, I think it's called Dolly's Fixins. Because something tells me she can cook a mean-ass breakfast. This is, you want to be the queen? You want to save the world? You want to give millions of dollars to Vanderbilt to come up with a vaccine? This woman did it. Imagination Library, free books to every kid in Tennessee that's born, at least in Sevierville County.
Dolly's Dixie Fixins.
Dolly's Dixie Fixins. Mm-hmm. She probably took Dixie out because she realized that was that some people were offended by that, and she took it out of something she used to do.
She was cool with it in 2006.
In 2006, she was fine with it. Right. Well, they all were. Okay. Here's what Dolly does. If you want to be as successful as Dolly, now I can't agree to these terms, but maybe you termites can. I get up. I'm a very, very early riser, she said. I go to bed pretty early, but I'm up and down. If I wake up and I'm pretty well awake, I think I've got so much to do. I'll get up, work a little while, write a little while, and then I'll lay back down. But I'm always, always up for good, instead of up for bad, around 3 a.m. If I am awake at 3 a.m., someone should put me down because I've clearly gotten into some sort of shots and it's still going and it shouldn't be. I don't shoot rumble mints. That's a Jackie Cation. That's hardcore. Jackie's from Wisconsin. That's hardcore upper Midwest drinking shoes put on.
Yeah.
St. Louis, a little more beer, shot every now and then. A fireball. They're so sweet, though. Ugh. Rumble mints probably better. I'd rather shoot, like, a flavored vodka or something. Anyway, she gets
lemon
up.
Drops.
Lemon drops.
Yeah.
But that's actually a martini battles.
No, it could also be a shot.
It could also be a shot, that's true. And that's delicious.
So good.
Yeah. Or a shot of moonshine. Because there's a, which is why, what am my beer glass? What am I drinking out of? Old Smoky Moonshine in where? Gatlinburg, Tennessee. You guys should go there. I may have already talked about it, but that place is wonderful because they have little testing flights. So you don't have to commit to a whole jar of whatever you like. You could say, yes, I'd like to taste the coffee, the mocha moonshine, and they really taste like that. It's not bullshit. The watermelon is delicious. The vanilla, one of my all-time hunch punch. Oh, so good. And then you just pick what you like, and then you can buy some, and you're not drunk because they're tiny, tiny, tiny shots, tasting shots, free flights, I think, or it might have been $7, but totally worth it. Anyway, that's where I did my banjo dancing too. The only music I can dance to. You should sometime. I'll post that. Anyway. She gets up between 3 a.m. She gets up at 3 a.m. And between 3 a.m. and 7 a.m., I get more work done than that little period of time when the world calms down, energies are down, and I feel like a farmer. They say the early bird gets the worm. Well, they also get a lot of good ideas, too. Before she does any writing or career-related activities, she always does one thing first. I'm a spiritual person. Every day before I do anything, I wake up and I thank God for the night and ask Him to bless the day, to bring all the things, all the wrong people out of my life, bring all the right stuff in, and just to guide me, lead me. And I always pray that He'll lift me up, lift up mankind, and we can glorify Him. She always dresses street ready. She keeps her makeup on and my hair done, and I actually do wear high heels most of the time. They're not as high as the ones I wear for a show, but I'm little. I'm short. That's right. She's 5 foot tall. So am I. Well, I'm 5 foot one. At least that's what I think I am. And I have to wear heels in order to reach my cabinets. I have to wear high heels to brush my teeth because the man who built my house thought it would be an upgrade to give me higher bathroom sink vanity deals. And I didn't. I've never built a house, and I didn't even think about it. And now I hate them. It's the one thing, if I could change, about this house. It's all too high. It's for tall people. I'm like, yeah, my brother-in-law could, yeah. Like, to spit toothpaste out, I have to, like, either have high heels on or jump. That's ridiculous. And she cooks a big breakfast for her husband, Carl, every morning, but it doesn't say what kind of breakfast, which is a little disappointing. I know she does biscuits and gravy. She makes a mean biscuits and gravy, which is probably my favorite breakfast of all time. And I would recommend the biscuits and gravy at Cracker Barrel and at Bob Evans, if you're near Bob Evans. Speaking of the queen of all termites, she did this week too. Ready for this? When she's not helping funding a vaccine research or supporting Black Lives Matter movement or inventing a successful meme, the monarch of country music, Dolly Parton, is apparently saving lives. Yeah. Parton, who stars in the Netflix holiday movie, Dolly Parton's Christmas on the Square. I couldn't get through it. I talked about that, but I wanted to, but maybe I'll fast forward and there'll be dialogue. I can't, the musical shit. I've never bought it. Not unless there's Nazis involved. AKA Sound of Music. She reportedly saved 9-year-old co-star Talia Hill by pulling her away from the path of an oncoming vehicle. We were on the set and I was at the hot chocolate station, of course. I would be like, what? Why isn't that a beer station? And they said, go back to your positions. Taylor said, Talia said in an interview with Inside Edition. So there was this moving vehicle and I was walking and somebody grabbed me and pulled me back and it was Dolly Parton. She said, that the girl, the 9-year-old, told Dolly Parton that she saved her life. And Dolly Parton told her, well, I am an angel, you know, a reference to her role in the Netflix film. But I think she's an actual real angel. I was in shock. She hugged me and I shook and I said, you saved my life. And my mom's going, yes, she did. Dolly, you saved her life. So there you go. That's what she did last week. What have you termites done? I didn't do anything quite that spectacular at all. I caught a fish. I threw it back, but I think it was dead. So, well, I think I killed it the way it got caught. I don't know. I hope not. It did swim away, but not very strongly, as Trumpy would say. Not very strongly or bigly. It was weak. All right. Update. How cool is this? Banksy, who we've talked about, the artist in England who just does pop-up artwork to make people happy, he struck again. This is, I really had never heard of this guy. Well, kind of, but I didn't know enough about it, what he does. But this is crazy. The owners of a house in Bristol have apparently pulled out of the sale of the property after a Banksy piece appeared on the wall. On Thursday, the anonymous street owners confirmed he was behind the artwork showing an older woman sneezing with her sneezing out her false teeth, which has appeared on a semi-detached house in Steep Vale Street, Totter Town. I know where none of that is. The stencil mural, achoo, has been covered up before its unveiling, which is good, so nobody can fuck with that. That's good. It shows a woman in a headscarf holding a handkerchief but dropping her walking stick, aka cane, and handbag as she loses her dentures while sneezing. Banksy confirmed on his website and Instagram account. See, I saw this on Instagram and I went, holy shit, he did it again. It's just great. It makes people so excited. They get so happy. In the photograph posted by him, the woman appears to be blowing over a wheelie bin and a man's umbrella with her sneezing. I don't understand what a wheelie bin is. A cart? Shopping cart? I don't know. It's the steepest residential street in England. It's 22 degree slope. Is used during an annual Easter egg rolling competition.
Is a garbage can.
It's a garbage can?
Yeah.
All right. Mm-hmm. ITV News West Country spoke to the owners of the house, which had a sold sign outside, but they were told they've pulled out of the sale. Yeah, I would too if I had Banksy on the side of my house. Stay in now. Yeah, until there's the highest bidder. They were due to exchange contracts next week, but the artwork could see the value of their house rocket. Imagine if you were the people that was going to buy it, though, and you're all excited. You got a new house. It's new to you, anyway. And then you're like, he did what? That fucking dude? God damn it. Because it's a total working class neighborhood. You can tell by the pictures online. The people have been climbing over the house to get a better look. People are all up there. We wanted to come because people deface it. So they got a workshop. They got a piece of acrylic. They covered it. Everybody's very excited. Let's see if I have anything else. It's not the first Banksy to spring up during the pandemic. No, because we talked about this. The girl hula hooping with a tire that appeared in Linton, Nottingham. Where is Nottingham, Paddles?
It's where Robin Hood's from.
It's where Robin Hood's from?
Yeah.
Okay. Where is in England is Nottingham? Look of Nottingham. Hey, I think I've heard of Nottingham Hill. Have I not?
Notting Hill.
Oh, well, I threw a ham in there. Why? Because I like ham. It's halfway between Birmingham and Leeds. All right, then. Excellent. Okay. This is an update. Jerry Falwell. The gift that never stops giving. In his lawsuit, Falwell alleged that Liberty damaged his reputation because it accepted without verifying what he called false statements by a man who had an affair with Falwell's wife and attempted to extort them. Okay, Jerry, here's the thing. Even if that part is true, How about the picture you posted of yourself on Instagram with your pants down and a glass full of Merlot? Nobody did that, Jerry. You did. That's right. And you know what? You are the president of a university that says no drinky drinky, no sexy sexy if you're not married, and you're posting pictures of somebody who isn't your wife and you have your pants down and so does she. Underwear on? Yeah, but still, inappropriate. Boom, fired. That's what I would say. I don't even give a shit about your affair with, I don't know about what was going on there. I've decided to take time out from my litigation against Liberty University, but I will continue to keep all options on the table for an appropriate resolution to this matter. So now he's trying to play nice, because I think they said, look, we'll let, this is what I think the super Christianese usually do. They say, go away for a while, and we will let you back in time. But in the meantime, shut your goddamn mouth and stop suing us. Just stop it. Go away. We'll let you back. Falwell's unilateral and voluntary dismissal was not prompted by any payments, promises, or other considerations from Liberty, the school said. Doubtful. Attorney, unless he thought he didn't have a case, but there's enough lawyers out there that'll take anything. Attorneys for Falwell on Wednesday notified the Lynchburg Circuit Court that he would not pursue his claim, but did not state a reason for the withdrawal. So, Jerry, there's your update. He's going to enjoy Christmas and be quiet. Just shut up, Jerry. Just shut up. This is not an update, but I tweeted about this. I really liked, back in the day, the country singer Charlie Pride. Now, for you young people, he was one of the first black country singers that of that era, anyway, that somebody my age would remember. And he had this song that I love called Kissing Angel Good Morning and Let Her Know You Think About Her When You're Gone. Now, he was on the CMAs just recently, within the last 2 months, that thing aired and it was live. And I happened to be, at the same time, texting my friend George Wallace. Do you know who George Wallace is? He's a very, very funny comedian. George, I call him Papa George. He's older, 70s, I don't know. And I was joking, I was saying, turn on the CMAs in text, and he said he opened for Charlie Pride for a bunch of shows. No and way. I said, no fucking way. And he said, because George is black also, and they don't really look alike, but from a distance, they're kind of built the same, and they're both black. And he said, because Charlie was a country guy, but nobody knew. They just heard his songs on the radio, and then they'd go to the concert, and they'd be like, holy shit, he's black, a black guy. And Charlie addressed all that. But George said, he goes, when I opened for Charlie Pride, you ain't never seen so many white people confused. First I come out, and they're like, well, how'd Charlie Pride get funny all of a sudden? And then Charlie Pride really comes out, and they're like, well, who was that other man? There's two Charlie Prides. This is crazy. He said, finally, I told Charlie, we got to stop confusing white people. Only one black man on a show in country at a time. But so Charlie was on the CMAs, and then I Googled it. He's 84, 86, I can't remember. 86. And he looked great, and he sang Kiss an Angel Good Morning. I'm like, oh, my God, he's still alive. This is fantastic. But then I had this next thought I thought was, we are in the middle of a global pandemic, and Charlie's 86, and not a person in that audience has a mask on. They had all these tables, these round tables. The tables were distanced, yes, but there's people. It just didn't. Charlie seemed very healthy. So maybe have Charlie sing that song from his house. Maybe we don't let an 86-year-old, or we just say, Charlie, we love you. Do you feel like you'll live another year? Are you healthy? Let's do it next year. Or we'll do it from your house, and we will bring all the camera crew, keep them way, way distance. I just thought it was ridiculous. Well, turns out Charlie died of COVID. And, you know, somebody, there's been chatter on Twitter. I guess Maren Morris, the country girl person. I don't know enough about country music.
Country girl.
Well, I don't know. She's a blonde
lady.
She's
not a rodeo lady. She's got brown hair.
She has brown hair?
Yeah.
Oh, then I don't know who she is, but I know the name. I've heard it.
Wow.
If you ain't Kellie Pickler, I don't got time for you in country music. Her song about her mama being gone is one of the most tearful things I've ever heard. Anyway, Charlie died, And now there's chatter on Twitter, and the CMAs had released a statement saying everybody was tested. Shut up, shut up. No, I don't care if everyone was tested. He's 86. He's a national treasure. You don't let him, even if he wants to, you go, Charlie, here's the thing. Very dangerous for old people. So we're not doing this. But I Googled Charlie Pride because I just didn't know his story. I mean, I knew he showed up. But here's some highlights that, or, you know, whatever the facts that are pretty astonishing. He was born in 1934 in Sledge, Mississippi. Now, I've been to Mississippi a lot, and I don't even know where that is. But it doesn't sound big. He was the fourth of 11 children of poor sharecroppers. He had 8 boys, 3 girls were in the family. His elder brother, Mac Pride, played Negro League baseball before entering the ministry. So did Charlie Pride.
Sledge has a population of 492.
492, and they were 11 of them. The Prides, Pride family. Mm-hmm. In 1953, he signed a contract with the Boise Yankees, a C-class farm team of the New York Yankees. During that season, an injury caused him to lose the, quote, mustard on his fastball. And he was sent to the Yankees Class D team in Fond du Lac, Wisconsin. Later that season, while in the Negro Leagues with the Louisville Clippers, two players, this is really funny, Pride and Jesse Mitchell, were traded to the Birmingham Black Barons for a team bus. Charlie said, Jesse and I may have the distinction of being the only two players in history to be traded for a used motor vehicle. He mused that in his 1994 autobiography, which I actually would buy at this point. Then he went into the Army. He was a quartermaster. This is crazy. He did everything. Then he came back from the Army and he had tryouts with the California Angels and the New York Mets, but he wasn't picked. But then he moved to Helena, Montana.
Helena, right.
Sorry. I've been there. I should know that.
It's the capital.
It is the capital, right. He was recruited to pitch for a local semi-pro team, the Smelterites.
What?
Yep. And the team manager helped him get a job at the local Arco lead smelter. The lead smelter kept 18 jobs open specifically for baseball players and ranger shifts so they could play. He loved living in Montana, even though they were the only black people. And he said it was weird, you know, but once they let you in, there was minor racism. They were refused service in a restaurant. And another time a realtor refused to show them a home, but she felt that the family endured less racism, this is his wife, than she saw leveled at the local Native American people. So, it's interesting.
There's also 800 people in Montana.
Right, there's hardly anyone there. So if somebody gets mad at you, that's all the racism right there in that one person. It's very conservative. I stood out like a neon, Charlie said, but once they let you in, you become a Montanan. When the rumor went around that I was leaving, they kept saying, we let you in, you can't leave now. Okay, that's a little creepy. I don't need to stay forever. People are allowed to move. So he had all these crazy jobs. And then he got married and had a wife and kids and grandkids and 2 great-grandkids, so that's all good. He was very happy. But here's another thing. Pride was a fan and part owner of the Texas Rangers. Good for Charlie.
Nice.
Yep. I'm not putting all the blame on CMAs. But I'm saying they should think about that for the next pandemic. If you invite my queen and she dies of COVID, I will personally file some sort of lawsuit. Okay, it's time for my most fun segment. Animals most likely to kill you in your state. Thanks to who? Lewis Black, comedian, playwright. Anyway, he's now unemployed. Lewis Black, unemployed, is now what? Mama Termite's research assistant. This was a good one. He sends me good stuff, too. He's very good at this. I'm not paying him. No one's being paid. Although this is getting so popular, I might get an advertiser. So I make some money. Would that piss the termites off? I promise it would only be something I believe in.
Lewis got a t-shirt.
Yeah, Lewis got a Pubcast t-shirt.
Yeah.
He got paid.
Right.
Those are worth whatever I pay for. Okay, animals most likely to kill you in your state. This little holiday thought. Colorado. What do you think it is, Paddles? If you're taking a walk in Colorado, there was...
Bear?
Yeah. Not
one.
Yep.
Yeah.
Cougars. Little to no information has been collected in Colorado concerning human beings killed by animals. Well, why, Colorado? Why are you not keeping track of this? If you come across a dead body on a trail and it's been eaten by an animal, you don't report that? This is shocking. Yes, taking into account the number of dangerous animals living in Colorado. Exactly. You could be bitten by rattlesnakes, mauled by a cougar, catch Rocky Mountain spotted fever from a tick. That's what I want to do. I want to write a country song called You Pick My Ticks. Well, that's because Ron White one time said, could you dig through my hair and look for a tick? And I did it, even though it grossed me out, because I thought I don't want him to die of Lyme disease.
No.
But I don't know why he thought he had a tick. I didn't even ask that.
It's a lot of hair.
Well, he may have been illegally helping me cut down a tree. Which he did gracefully, and I have a video of that too. You could be jabbed by the horns of a mountain goat or even bitten by a venomous spider such as the brown recluse. We have those in the Midwest. Always be careful of anything in the garage, in a box. Don't put your hand in a box that you can't see the bottom of, and do not sit on old furniture that has been outside. There. Don't tell me this podcast isn't informative. Although cougar attacks may not be that common, they are debatably the most difficult to avoid as compared to all the other dead animals in the state. Okay. So that, well, you all saw that video of that guy that went 5 minutes long with that cougar, but that was in Utah. But I didn't even know cats could move like that. Like, it got on its ass and then started swatting in the air, but it was also moving. It was crazy to see. Go Google that. Connecticut. What do you think's going to kill you in Connecticut, Paddles? Martha Stewart.
Yes.
I made that up. This is strange. I don't know what I would think in Connecticut. Maybe bears, I would think.
No.
Well?
No.
You'll never guess it. Bobcats with rabies.
What?
Yep. This is a relatively safe state to reside in. That's what I would think. Especially in terms of animal-related attacks. For the most part,
waspy.
What?
It's very waspy.
It's very waspy, yeah. Yes. Parts of it are very elite. And then parts of it, not so much.
No.
Hartford, not so much.
A little sketchy.
I've done shows there, a little sketchy.
Boxwoods.
I was at the hotel one time, and I asked the guy, is there anywhere I can go get a beer? And he told me, like, where the street was, where there was, like, a tavern. But what he didn't tell me is where I had to walk to get to the tavern. And that would just show you my Midwest determination. When I need a beer and a burger for lunch, I'm willing to walk through extreme danger. And I did. Over railroad tracks, nonetheless. Bobcats are not hostile towards humans. I never have thought that, and I've seen a lot, and I chased them because I wanted to see it. Huh. This is right up Lou's alley. Lou thinks every animal outside has rabies, all of them. Bobcats are not hostile towards humans. However, this can change when they are diseased with rabies. Rabies is considered the reason for bobcats attacked, according to the Connecticut Department of Energy and Environmental Protection. So that's it, Connecticutans. What do you guys call yourself? Connecticutites? Connecticutites? I don't know. Be careful. If you see a bobcat and it looks like it might come towards you, run! I have a lot of animal stuff this week. Not on purpose. This is so fucked up. And I try to pick stories and things to talk about that I would want to talk about at my bar, because this bar is open. So I don't like to really... I don't really want, like, headlines that are common. So this got a little common this week, but I thought it was worth repeating in case you guys didn't hear it. Rats besiege New York Chipotle, eating avocados and attacking staff.
What?
Yeah, hang on, Paddles. As columnist Mary Schmitz once said in life, there are certain inalienable truths. Prices will rise, politicians will philander, and I'm going to add one. You can always count on New York for a good old rat story. Today, that story is of the Upper Manhattan Chipotle food chain rats who have been feasting on avocados and burritos and, by the sounds of it, disturbed staff. At first glance, it might sound like small potatoes when compared to the CDC had to warn against when the CDC had to warn against New York's cannibal rats during the pandemic, nor does it sound quite as frightful as the starved super rats so desperate to dine out that they threw themselves at horrified New Yorkers who were dining al fresco. No, today's rats have been running amok at Washington Heights Chipotle, attacking employees. Okay, this shouldn't be plural. It shouldn't say employees. After employee, period, there should be no more employees.
Right.
Right? Yeah. Either I quit. Oh no, I got a text from Bob who said he got attacked by a rat last night. Fuck you, I'm going to Fridays. Or where, there's a Red Lobster in Times Square. You can find other chains in New York City. They've been attacking employees, chewing through wiring systems, and causing the indefinite closure of the restaurant to the public. Well, yeah, it's pure chaos every time a rat appears. Holy shit, employee Melvin Polino told the New York Post, speaking of the brazen behavior of the rats, although the restaurant is closed. Okay, this doesn't make sense to me. If the restaurant is closed, why are there avocados? Which, by the way, when you live in the Midwest, your avocado lasts about 2 goddamn days. And now I've lived in California and they last a lot longer because they get to you quicker. But here in the hinterworld, it takes forever. And New York, I'd think even longer. They don't last. Why are there avocados in the place if it's closed? Nobody explains that. Bad journalism. Bad. Even though the restaurant is closed, the staff regularly come in to clean in an effort to help stave off infestation. This includes some pretty serious survival tactics, including stomping rats and whacking them with broom handles.
No,
I'm going to get unemployment. How much are you making at Chipotle? Am I saying that right?
Chipotle.
I hate that place. You know why?
It's delicious.
I hate it. I know, Paddles, you'll stand up for it. Here's why.
Because you like Taco Bell.
Well, I do like Taco Bell, but they have the two seasoning, I guess that's what you call them, I don't know, spices that I hate the most in life. Cumin, cilantro.
That's a staple in Mexican food, cilantro.
You can always ask for no cilantro in guacamole. They don't even have a problem with it. The no, Mexicans do not put cilantro in their rice. Chipotle does. It's already like basted in chipotle.
Nobody goes to Chipotle for the rice.
Cilantro. It comes with everything. You don't even have to ask for it. It's everywhere. I can't. One time I had a quote, wasn't a real job. Lewis had a show, Root of All Evil on Comedy Central, and I went in every day to be a writer because he wasn't there yet and he was afraid that the people wouldn't write what he liked. So I said, well, you go in. And I said, I don't know, Lewis. What time do I have to be there? He said, 10. That worked. I can do that. But they would get those staff lunches. Some intern would come up. I always found it so laborious. Like, it took 10 people an hour to eat a bagel. Then they'd start. It was so slow. Then lunch took an hour. Like, fucking, come on. The ordering took an hour. What are we having? Chipotle? I don't like Chipotle. Is there any other options? No. Okay. I'll have rice, no cilantro. And then it just got ridiculous. It took like 7 hours to get a lunch order for those interns. I felt bad for them. Anyway, that's why I hate Chipotle. It's not my thing. But anyway, the infestation was first discovered in the summer when avocados were found partly eaten and bags of rice bitten through. The rats seemed to have developed the same expensive taste for avocados as many New Yorkers. They liked them so much at Chipotle, eventually had to move the fruit to the freezer to keep the rats at bay. You can put an avocado in a freezer?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
How long does it last?
Don't know.
I've never heard of that. They closed the location after the rats chewed through the wiring of its computer system so badly they could no longer handle orders. Oh, okay, so they were doing to-go, so that's why they had avocados. And then they had to tell people, sorry, the rats ate our computers, so I definitely would want to order from there. Oh, my God.
Yeah, that's where you go home.
Well, that's where you don't continue to eat there. I mean, come on. By the way, did you people know pack rats are real?
Yes.
Most people don't know that. I thought pack rat was just a phrase for people who collected too much stuff. And at our farm, my dad kept finding piles of wires and steel, anything shiny. And then he opened up the riding lawnmower. Oh, no, a four-wheeler. No, the riding lawnmower and the four-wheelers. And the wires had been dismantled. So then he went up to the local feed store hardware thing all in one. And the guy's like, you got pack rats. And my dad didn't know even, and we've lived on farms, but we didn't know this. They're adorable. They have giant Mickey Mouse ears. They don't look like a regular rat. They're way cuter, but they're extremely destructive. And so one day out at the farm, my dad, they're riding lawnmower. He goes, I know he's in there. And my dad had a gun. He goes, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to lift up the hood of the riding lawnmower, and he's going to be right there in the middle of this nest he's made, and I want you to shoot it.
What?
And I said, Dad, there's nothing about this plan that sounds right. If that bullet ricochets off the metal engine of the riding lawnmower, either me or you are going to get hit. At the very least, we're going to be scared. You'll have a heart attack. And then I got to deal with that. And the cell phones don't work out here in the woods. So he said, all right, fine, I'll shoot it. I go, no, you're missing my point, Dad. You're missing my point, Jackalope. My dad's name is Jack, but I like to call him Jackalope. You're missing my point. And so I said, let's just open the hood because I've never seen one. I want to see it. And then if it runs, I'll follow it and shoot it. But I'm not shooting it in a lawnmower that I believe, by the way, still has gas in it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Sometimes my dad is so smart, and then other times I'm like, Jackalope, I don't think shit through, but you're really not thinking shit through.
You gotta reel him in.
It's a he gets too overexcited about the idea that he's gonna win. He's gonna kick this pat. And if there's one, there's more. But even under the hunting cabin, there were piles of, and it was a nest. I mean, it was a true, like, bird's nest of steel and wire. They're very good with their hands. Anyway, he lifted up the hood, and it wasn't there. Thank God. There was no pet. That's just a little something. Speaking of animals, it's getting crazier with the minks.
Oh, God.
Yep. Mink farm in British Columbia, Fraser Valley, tested positive. Minks at the farm test positive for coronavirus, and so did 8 workers. 5 mink samples have tested positive for COVID. Okay, I did not know. I know what a mink is. I did not know people were still buying mink coats. I mean, I know there's the anti-fur thing, which I just would be fine with that because I don't have a fur coat. I've never wanted a fur coat. But apparently, who's buying mink coats? Like, the last person I saw do that was when I worked at the Tropicana. There was a comedy club, the Comedy Stop at the Trop, which I believe is now the Laugh Factory in Vegas. The club switched from the Comedy Stop at the Trop. That, and then on the second floor of the Tropicana, they had very expensive stores, and one was a fur store. And one night, Mike Tyson came in at the height of his popularity, and me and the other comedian, whose name I think I was working with Al Ramos, who's very, very funny too. You can Google him. And we went down just because we wanted to see Mike Tyson in person, like see him, like gawk, like rubberneck,
nice.
Like dumb fox. Come on, how many times are you going to get to see him up close? And it's a tiny store. It had a shitload of furs because I was so bored because I'd worked there for 7 days. That was your gig, Monday through Monday, and you did 2 shows a night at that club. And, you know, you can't gamble all the time, and I wasn't even making enough to gamble anything more than quarters, which is depressing, but not at the time because I didn't know you didn't go to dollars. Anyway, Mike came out with about 6 fur coats held by 3 different men, and I thought, he's the guy.
And rappers.
Rappers like them?
Yeah.
Fur coats?
Yeah, Lil Nas has one.
Lil Nas does?
Yeah.
Well, good for him. I love Lil Nas. Yeah, I hope it's not real, though. Why are we kidding? Minks are ferret-like animals that are farmed around the world for their fur. There are 60 mink farms across the country, according to the Fur Council of Canada. Last month, the Danish government ordered all farm minks to be culled. Those are the zombie minks. Remember? We talked about that, the ones that came out of the earth. After finding 12 people had been infected by a unique strain, muted strain of the coronavirus, oh, that's not good, which causes COVID-19, which passes from humans to mink, then back to humans. If minks are infected, there's no potential for the virus to mutate within the mink population, but it can mutate to us. A lot of those mutations they're finding potentially relative to that spike protein, which is obviously concerning because that's a vaccine's target that's being developed. The province says the samples are being tested to determine the genome sequencing and the strain of the virus. It says the outbreak. Here's where there's mink farms. Denmark, well, we know Canada. the Netherlands, Spain, Sweden, Italy, and the United States. I've been on the road for 742 years, never come across a mink farm. If I did, I didn't know it. I didn't know it was such a big thing. I didn't know people cared that much about a mink coat. It's just a little ferret. Like, I would just leave it alone. That's just me. Update. That's a good one. The Netflix series Tiger King left a mark on 2020, and now it may contribute to a more lasting legacy. On Thursday, the House of Representatives passed the Big Cat Public Safety Act, a bill featured in the show that would ban most big cat ownership. The bill, which was passed 272 to 114. So 114 people in the House of Representatives said, fuck it, I don't care who owns a tiger. How about that for throwing a hammer down? The bill limits who's able to transport, sell, buy, breed, or possess big cats, including lions, tigers, leopards, cheetahs, jaguars, cougars, or hybrids of those animals. The bill, mostly individuals will not be allowed to privately own big cats, and all direct public contact with the animals, including cub petting, will be forbidden. Listen, I'm the first one, and I shouldn't do it. I know it. But in Florida specifically, there'll be a sign on the road that says, do you want to see my tiger? $2. And I think, yes, I do. And me and Vic Henley, my friend who passed away, the comedian, we were suckers for that shit. And I know we shouldn't have been supporting him. I get it. But I don't think $2 was going to go either which way. And we were bored on the road. We probably shouldn't have done it, but we did it. But then you would see the conditions and you'd go, this doesn't seem right or legal. And I also feel like they can get out. That's just me observing it. Doesn't mean I'm right. I thought it was fucked up. I didn't know you could just own a tiger and have it like in a, you know, kind of a dog kennel and just hope for the best.
You can't.
Well, they do in Florida, every other exit. You want to see my leopard? Yeah, I do.
You in Gatorland.
Gatorland in Florida is, that's for a different show. It's right by Disney World. And I thought, Gatorland looks questionable. Disney World is not. I can go spend $150 at Disney World. I don't care about anything Disney. Or I can spend $28 and go into Gatorland and perhaps watch a child be eaten. What am I doing? And they serve alcohol at Gatorland.
Tall boys.
I'll tell you about Gatorland in a different podcast because it's worth going deep into that. And I don't really know how I feel about the safety of Gatorland, but I know as a customer, I kind of felt super alarmed the entire time I was there, but it's exhilarating. It's exciting. So this is what's going to happen. They're not going to let this go on anymore. And I don't think it should. Those who own big cats that were born before the act was enacted will be permitted to keep their animals so long as they register the animal and do not breed it or allow it near the public. They get out. There was a tiger loose in Knoxville, Tennessee, about 3 months ago for a month. And I never heard the end of it, which means it either never happened, but there's too many people saying it did. And what do you get for saying that? Nothing. You don't get money. You don't get anything. You just look kind of crazy. Most people wouldn't want to do that. I believed the people that said, God damn it, there's a tiger in my backyard. Somebody needs to come get it.
It went to Gatlinburg.
It might have gone. Maybe it went to Sevierville. Yeah. Maybe it's at Dollywood.
It's a Dolly fan.
You could be fined $20,000 and imprisoned for 5 years. There are roughly 10,000 big cats in the U.S. and more tigers in captivity than there are in the wild. They live in poor conditions. It just goes on and on. So they're going to put an end to my the little places in Florida. Me and Vic used to get off the highway and go. Some of the ones in Florida are drive-through, too. And they repeatedly say through your radio when you're driving through these places, do not exit your vehicle. And inevitably, someone will. And that's why I go through the park. I want to see one more dumb American get eaten. Is that wrong? Maybe.
No.
Speaking of snakes, speaking of animals, I wasn't speaking of snakes, I'm aware of that. I haven't watched this yet, but termites, the super strange termites like myself, this is so up my alley. Courtesy of who? Research assistant Lewis Black. How did I miss this? There's a movie on HBO. It debuted on December 9th at 8 p.m. I haven't had a chance. It's called Alabama Snake on HBO, featuring Minister's Deadly Plan with Rattlesnake. Alabama Snake, the story of a Pentecostal minister, Glenn Summerford, will premiere Wednesday, December 9th at 8 p.m. Serpent handler, attempted to murder his wife with a rattlesnake. The film will be on HBO. Now, here's the thing. When you live in the Midwest, and you travel through the South, mostly, I know for a fact there's a snake handling church in Kentucky, which would literally be 3 hours from the city of St. Louis. So just when you think you're very far away from the snake handlers, you're not. They're out there. And they had a documentary show, not this one, I haven't seen this. This is called Alabama Snake. Paddles will put it in the show notes. HBO. I think it was a series about snake handling. It only lasted like 1 year, like one set, maybe 10 episodes. And this one lady goes, she's from Kentucky. She said, well, I married him and I knew he was a preacher, but I didn't know he was a handler. And they speak like that, like that's just a common term. And I know it could kill him, but I love him. Okay, it doesn't have to be that simple. There could be a conversation. Hey, chubby, here's the thing. I don't care if you have your snakes in cages. Well, I would care. But let's say she's going to be concessatory. Is that a word? Made that up, probably. She's going to concede. You can keep your snakes, but I don't want you handling them. You don't just go, he does it. I love them. No. You say, look, we have children. You're not going to die, fatty. Not, you're going to die from being that fat, but you're not going to die of a goddamn rattlesnake bite because you think the Lord will fix it. And the one episode, the Lord didn't fix it. He died in a recliner. And he was like 42.
You got to get rid of the snake.
Well, I would concede and say, look, I know it was a lot of trouble to go find all these snakes under rocks. Well, once you find a rattlesnake den, you found a million of them, which is even more disgusting. I know because I went on a rattlesnake roundup for ESPN2 in Big Spring, Texas. And I it still gives me the creeps. But anyway, go look that up. Also, something else cool. Then we're done with animals. I know I've talked a lot about animals today, but it kept coming up. This is one of the coolest things I've ever seen. And I gotta say, if I was at the meeting when we were doing our budget, I don't know if I would agree to this because I think it's a lot of money. But now that I've seen what it's done, I would have spent double. In 2018, Utah officials spent $5 million building a special bridge for wildlife to cross a busy stretch of I-80 outside Salt Lake City.
What?
Yep. It goes over the highway.
That's great.
It's so awesome. 2 years later, the Utah Division of Wildlife Resources proudly shared a video showing a variety of wildlife making use of the bridge. It's crazy. There's goats, there's deer, bears.
They thought it was the Ark.
No, they want to get across the highway.
They just wanted to the Ark.
They don't think it's the Ark paddles. They're not thinking that hard.
Yes, they are.
They're animals who want to get to the other side. You should go Google that. Just put in Animal Bridge, Utah, and the video will come up.
Put it in the show notes.
Show notes, paddles. Show notes. This is a lovely story. In the spirit of the holidays, you know, Canada always goes over the top to be nice, which is why I still work there, even though it's a pain in my ass, because they want $6 in taxes every year, which I repeatedly pay, and then they go, you still owe us $6. I'm like, whatever, Canada. Justin Trudeau, how can you do this to me? I don't really care. I like going there. They're nice people and they're fun. And they drink a lot, which makes me... beer. They're like Midwest people, except colder. A Canadian man drives a stranded American family 1,000 miles to Alaska.
That's nice.
Right?
Yeah, it's a Hallmark movie.
It is a Hallmark movie. Wait till you hear this story. This is crazy. There's nice, and then there's Canadian nice, which sometimes involves driving a total stranger, her two kids, a pair of elderly dogs, and a cat named Midnight more than 1,000 miles through a snowstorm to another country. It all started, this is a crazy story, because Lynn Marchessault, yeah, I said that right, a 13-year-old son, Peyton, 10-year-old daughter, Rebecca, and the family pets needed to get from Georgia to Alaska. Her husband, a staff sergeant in the U.S. Army, is stationed at Fort Wainwright in Fairbanks. Again, why Alaska should be part of Canada. Let's stop acting like it's America, because it's fucking not. When you say, I gotta go from Georgia to Alaska, you should never say that out loud, ever, for any reason, but she had to. So she packed up all their belongings, bought a 4x4 truck that could handle Alaska winters, rented a U-Haul, and made plans for a cross-country family adventure during the balmy days of early fall. But then 2020 happened. She waited for months for the travel documents that would allow her to drive from Georgia through Canada and up to Alaska, because you got to get through Canada, so now the borders are closed. Rut-row. So she had to get special papers. That had to be a giant, enormous pain in her ass. I don't know how hot the husband is, but I might have said, well, let's wait till there's a vaccine. She waited. Due to the coronavirus, Canada has instituted strict guidelines for America's traveling through the country, because they lied, too. A lot of Americans said, oh, I'm just coming up, and then they stayed forever. And then Canada caught on, and you started getting rewards for pointing out bad Americans. By the time she got her things in order in September, her road trip was pushed to November. Besides the restrictions placed on her by the Canadian government, she knew she'd have to keep up a good driving pace to avoid the worst of the winter weather. Over the first 3,000 miles, 3,000 miles, again, why that's not America, went well. The weather was good, the kids were glued to electronic devices, the dog behaved, and the cat slept. Here's the one thing you don't want, the cat going crazy in the car. That could be bad. Midnight could have stayed home. You're right. I don't know why they felt the need to bring the cat, but I'm going to blame it on the 10-year-old girl, because that would have been me. We can't leave the cat! What are you, a Nazi? That's what I would have said to my dad. What about Stormy? That was our cat. Well, we had a lot of cats, but... they entered Canada through the province of Saskatchewan. Border authorities checked the paperwork and wanted her to keep to the main roads. They warned her and stop only when necessary for food or gas. The family would have to order food to go, even at motels they stayed in along the way. She was allotted 5 days. They gave her 5 days to get through Canada to the U.S. border of Alaska. Well, not if it's snowing and shit, paddles. Yeah. This lady, even though I've driven in snow, would be going 30. The farther north they travel, the worse the weather got, said Marcia Salt, who was raised in the south. Oh, that's even worse. You ever seen those videos of Atlanta when it snows an inch? This is my favorite thing about, specifically Atlanta, because it happened a few years ago when they had the big snowstorm. And this is foreign to me because St. Louis, we get enough snow and ice that we kind of get the hang of it. We're not as good as Minnesota or Wisconsin, but we get it, right? The south doesn't get it. 2 inches of snow, and people on the Atlanta highways abandon their vehicles. I'm like, what the fuck is that? There's like 50 cars on the side of the road. People just walking around. This is crazy. How are we going to live?
You had a show.
What's going to happen? Oh, right, I had a show, and they called and said, are we still doing the show? I said, why wouldn't we? Well, there's a lot of snow out there. No, there's not. You people, they should do an exchange program once a year with Southerners and put them in upstate New York and teach them how to drive.
Minnesota,
somewhere. Although I will say one of the most shocking things, Minnesota, I went there and I can't remember who was with me. It might have been Vic again. I don't know. And I rented a car in Minneapolis to go to this gig, a casino gig. It was like an hour and a half away. But there had been like 12 inches of snow in Minnesota. And I thought, well, these guys, they'll nail it. No problem. And not a single road was clear. I said to the rental car guy, I go, do they do downtown? Because I could see the roads and there was no... He's like, oh, no, you know, you just figure it out. I'm like, no. You're Minnesota. You should deal with this shit. And he's like, we're short on snowplows. Call Prince. He was still alive at the time. If he's dead, call his estate. Prince would have donated a snowplow, and it probably would have been purple. How cool would that be? Yeah. It's the purple plow. Come on, bitches. The purple plow's out. But they're just so good at driving in it, they didn't even care. I cared. But they didn't care. Anyway, got off the story. The weather got worse as they kept, because she's from the south. Then she ran out of windshield wiping fluid. Oh, God. Slush covered her windows and she couldn't see out to drive. Even scarier, her tires seemed to be losing traction. Oh, no. Don't tell me this lady didn't get snow tires. Even I would have known that. At this point, I just needed to vent to somebody. And it all just started coming out. I explained how I was having trouble getting up the road. I wasn't getting any traction, she said. And let's check your tires. I was under the impression I had all-weather tires. That's what the dealership told me, but she checked, this lady at a gas station. She said, honey, these are summer tires. The good Samaritan drove Marsha Salt to a tire store, and they were able to change them on the spot. But she was done with driving. I'm not usually one to throw in the towel, but I threw in the towel. This is like an Atlanta person.
It's
a Fuck it. Yeah. Yeah. I told my husband, Border Patrol can just come and get us where we are. That's the only way we're leaving Canada at this point. That's a southerner just throwing it down.
Come get us.
Fuck you. You want me? Come get me.
I'm in Regina.
I'm in Regina. I never even heard of it. But it rhymes with vagina, and everybody laughs about ha 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 ha. The Massachusetts found a hotel motel and went to bed. That's when the kind folks in and around Wanawan, British Columbia got to work putting out a plea on Facebook for someone to drive these yahoos. I wrote, yeah. Someone to drive the Mars assaults, because I would have been with this lady. I am making fun of this lady, but I am that lady. So it's no fall there. Their truck, their U-Haul, the last 1,056 miles to the border. The trip takes a good driver familiar with the perilous Alaska highway in about 2 days.
In the Yukon.
This is something. Okay, there's a comedian, Lars Caliendo. You should follow Lars on everything. Because he is the quintessential dopey-ass, fun Canadian. He's so nice, though. Lars would do this. I know he would. Especially if it was me, I know he would. He would do anything. He's just the nicest man. Sometimes I don't understand him, but he's very strange. But he's very funny and very fun. But just a genuinely always looking to help nice person. And I'm not saying all Canadians are like that, but the ones I encounter usually lean that way.
Rand Paul didn't like him.
Oh, right. We met Rand Paul one time backstage. He was on a meet and greet list. And I looked at the list and I go, wait, the Rand Paul, the real one, wants to meet me? He would probably hate me, I would think. Not hate. Just not even, he doesn't seem like he'd even like comedy. Anyway, they came backstage, and it's his wife who liked me, and she is just a ball of fun, and I don't know why she likes him, because he is not fun, at least not that night. He's a very serious, serious little man, because I had 3-inch heels on, which makes me 5'4", and I could see most of the top of his head. Just saying. But I was trying to be nice to Rand, and I said, you know, I really like your policies on medical marijuana, because he was always been very fast forward thinking in that. And I said something about healthcare, and then Lars walked up and he goes, yeah, I don't know about your healthcare system, but Canada's is great. And Rand didn't like that, because that's socialized medicine. And I said, well, Lars, why don't you tell Mr. Paul something great about socialized medicine? He goes, well, when I was like 14, I broke my leg playing hockey. And they fixed it, and I never got a bill. And it's great. My leg's better than it was.
Great.
And I thought, there's your testimony. And I rest my case, Your Honor. There's my opening act, bringing it down at the meet and greet. You tell him, Lars. Okay, so hold on. If this family didn't get to the border soon, this is why it's like a Hallmark movie. They've only been given 5 days to get there. They would go past the 5-day maximum they were given to get to Alaska. Here comes Santa. Gary Bath, a ranger whose jobs include training members of the Canadian military to survive in the Arctic, was at home when he saw his friend's post about the stranded American family. That's not COVID. That's the amount of hot salt I put in that Bloody Mary. Ooh, shoo, buddy, as Ron White would say. After watching the post for a bit, I saw no one was able to help. So I talked to my wife and we made the decision I would drive her the whole way to the border. Both families met over the internet. This is such a Hallmark movie. And that's so good because I thought, I don't know, would I just let some guy? Probably because it's Canada and they think, but then, I don't know, there's Canadian serial killers too. They're not all angels. What if a devil decided to drive me to Alaska? So they did an internet interview, which I thought was super smart. I would have never thought of that. I'd have just been, it's a yay or a nay. Drink a beer, make up your mind. They decided they were all comfortable with the plan. Bath and his wife drove to meet the family at the motel. This lady's crying, holding a cat. I'd be like, no, fuck that, fuck that.
Are you allergic to cats?
Yeah. You want to meet Midnight? He's real nice, except when he's not. Yeah. Well, Marcia's Salt admits making the trip so late in the year turned out to be an error in judgment. Allowing Bath to drive them was not. I'm a very good judge of character, and I knew I made the right choice, and these were good people. With Bath behind the wheel, she was able to relax and reflect on what she'd been through to drive when she tried to drive under the same condition. I'm sure my son was happy. He didn't have to comfort me anymore as I cried. It was more of a dry heave cry, she explained while laughing. You can't cry with actual tears because then you can't see the road. I was just gripping the steering wheel with white knuckles. And home to Alaska tonight. Remember, he's only got 2 days to get this whole circus up to Alaska. And then he has to drive home alone, too. Two more days of driving. Maybe he thought, I'm kind of sick of my wife and sick of this pandemic. I'm doing it. Bath found the long drive uneventful because he's Canadian to him, except for a blown tire that was fixed quickly, and the company enjoyable. We both have military families, so we talked about military lives, told family stories of the family. The kids played games. Lynn and I found out we were both weird and like the MERs, military food. He drove them to the Canadian border checkpoint where the Master Salts handed in their paperwork and the new they got cleared. Just like old friends, it was a really nice drive and he deserves all the credit. He's a good guy.
And then he snowshoed home.
Yeah. He did. He snowshoed home. With a Snickers bar.
And a Labatt's Blue.
And a Labatt's Blue in his pocket for when he got thirsty, you know? That was a nice Christmas story because it's the holidays, termites. It's funny, but it's not. Okay, I don't usually go too far into politics. We all know that. Because there's enough of that out there. And I think you all know how I feel anyway.
You love Justin Trudeau.
I love Justin Trudeau. If you've never Googled the picture of Justin Trudeau at a charity boxing match.
Delicious.
He doesn't have a shirt on and his hair is longer and curlier. Enough said. And people, I know I have Canadian listeners because I see a graph. And then there's other. Where are the rest of you people at? Are there really people overseas? I think that's wonderful.
Is that guy from Norway? He wants to marry you.
Yeah, I do have a guy from Norway that wants to marry me. And he's Jewish. He said he's a... No, he's from Finland. He's a... He's a Norwegian Jewish person. Probably because he knows how much I like Lou, so I'm down with the Jews. He's probably like, I can get in that way. She likes Lewis? Exactly. This, if you saw my act before the end of the pandemic, I had a chunk in about it that I think our politicians are too old. And I think there should be limits. If you have to be 35 to be the president, I don't really even know that you should, but all right, 35. Then I say at 75, you're done. Because it's getting ridiculous. This is how ridiculous it is. Chuck Schumer had several painful conversations with Dianne Feinstein, the oldest serving senator. She's 87. I'll repeat, 87. About stepping aside during the Supreme Court confirmation hearings, but she seemed to forget about their talks. This is what's so crazy. Like, I remember when we had, well, I didn't have to do it, but my dad had to tell my grandpa, that he couldn't drive anymore, so my dad took his keys. Now, the greatest thing is, my grandpa, the following week, I went up to get him to go take him to lunch because he liked Red Lobster. So did I. So do I. And he had a brand new Cadillac in the parking spot of his place. It was a pipe fitter's retirement home thing. Apartment place. Not like, wasn't a nursing home, but it was for all union pipe fitter people. Which is cool. Like, if you think about it, because everybody in that building he knew his whole life, for better or worse. And all he would talk about is how he didn't want to play poker with any Dutch people. I don't...
What?
Yeah. He was like, their racism was about races we don't even think about to be racist about anymore. You know what's wrong with the Dutch? And then my grandpa would tell you. I won't go into it. But anyway, my grandpa goes, you know, your father thinks he's smart, taking my keys. You know what I did? I got in a cab and I went to the car dealership and I got a new Cadillac. Don't tell him. I said, your secret's safe with me. But anyway, you know, my dad had to think about, like, when you're going to confront somebody about something that's sensitive and it's their life and it's time and, you know, their age, and you're basically saying you're not qualified anymore. So Chuck Schumer, probably any normal human anyway, would be the day before that, like, okay, how am I going to say this? What am I going to say? I don't want to hurt their feelings, but I want to get my point across. So he goes through all this bullshit. He delivers his speech, and an hour later, she doesn't even remember he did it. This is the problem. You waited too long, Chuck. You should have had this 10 years ago. Not now, because she doesn't even remember you had it. Several progressive groups publicly, the Democrats on Capitol Hill privately, have expressed concerns about Feinstein's cognitive abilities over the past year. But the questions came to a head in October when Feinstein, 87, led the Democrats during the Amy Coney Barrett's confirmation hearings to the Supreme Court. Yes, it's like, the joke's outdated now, but when it was the Supreme Court hearing for Kavanaugh, Chuck Grassley from Iowa, who I think is 111, he was like in charge and he couldn't hear. So there was like an intern sitting on the floor. They didn't even give the child a seat. And then Kavanaugh would say something, and then Chuck would go, well, now, what did he say? What did he say? And then my joke was, the kid would go, he said he likes beer. What? Chuck Grassley's too fucking old. This is, it's ridiculous. Like, no, there has to be a cutoff. Schumer said the Democratic leader spoke with her about moving aside on her own terms in an effort to keep her dignity intact. She was surprised and upset by his overtures. It's not an overture. An overture is something I'm suggesting that may or may not have validity. This is like, I'm just telling you the facts, lady. She wasn't really aware to the extent of which she'd been compromised. It was hurtful and distressing to have it pointed out. Well, tough shit. Tough shit. Feinstein, who'd been displaying short-term memory problems, clearly, she doesn't even remember she's mad at Chuck. She's mad at him when he's saying it. Then he goes to the bathroom, comes back. She's like, what up? How you? It was like Groundhog Day with the pain fresh each time, the person said. Schumer was so worried that he installed a trusted aide on the Judiciary Committee staff to ensure the hearing didn't go off the rails and to keep an eye on Feinstein. Former Feinstein aide defended her to senators, saying even if her facilities are diminished, she's still smarter and quicker than at least a third of the other members. Okay, that may be true, but that doesn't work for me. Just because at 50% of your original capacity, there's still people dumber than you, that doesn't mean you get to stay either. KK? Other aides, while speaking respectfully of her career and her accomplishment, told the magazine that her short-term memory is so poor that she often forgets she's been briefed on a topic, then criticizes her staff for not doing their jobs. I would love to be on that staff. Because it's fun because you never have to do anything.
Right.
Just go in and tell her the same shit every other hour. I got an update on the nomination process thing. Here's some more information about Amy. Thanks. And you come back an hour later. You haven't told me anything about Amy. I know. I'm so lazy. And then you read the same shit. It's an easy workload. The staff is in such a bad position. They have to defend her and make her seem normal. The Senate, where power is accumulated with seniority, that's part of the problem, too, is known for having a high average range, 61.8 years, among the oldest in U.S. history. Yeah, 61's fine, but 87? Then she hugged Lindsey Graham. And I remember putting on Twitter, all the liberals got mad saying, why is she hugging Lilo? I call him Lilo. Why is she hugging Lilo? I'm like, she doesn't know who she's hugging. Everybody just relax. And even if she is hugging him, so what? Who cares? And then Lindsey defended her. But Nancy Pelosi's 80. I'm not good with that either because my parents are 79. And I'll be talking to my parents, and we can go over that. That's it. Strom Thurmond was 90. He made it to like 150. He didn't even know he had black kids. Somebody had to tell him that. And then he went, oh, all right. Well, I'd like to meet him. Oh, my God. Exactly. One more thing, then we'll be done. Termites. I know I've rambled on today. Because I got a good night's sleep, I have extra energy. I don't, once again, this is political, but it made me laugh. Geraldo, who I quit paying attention to after the vault incident that took 2 hours out of my life to go look for Al Capone's vault, and it was just nothing, a hole in the ground. And then I fucking know Geraldo knew that. Well, he had to have, because, oh no, it was live. Remember when we all had to sit there with him with a flashlight? Asshole. He says, I could have been
the only person that stayed home for that.
No, I'm not the only person. All of America stayed home for that.
No, they didn't.
Yes, they did, Paddles. It was a big deal. We're going to bust into Al Capone's. I thought they'd find all kinds of old liquor and cool shit. Nothing. There was nothing. It was just a hole. Geraldo says Rush Limbaugh's reckless and irresponsible talk of secession is treason. Rush Limbaugh, I'm not really proud to say, is from Missouri. Another person that we could have. And when everybody says, oh, Rush Limbaugh, you know, he, I would say, who are you listening to? Same thing with CNN or Fox. When these people are talking, like, okay, I never agreed with Pat Buchanan, but I understood why Pat Buchanan was talking on television because he had a history of working in politics and for many presidents and writing books. They always ended up, no matter what Pat Buchanan wrote a book about, it could have been a book about holiday recipes. The last chapter would always be, we're running out of white people and I'm super scared. That was always his last chapter. Western Europeans are dying. What the fuck are we going to do about it? Anyway, I'm not a fan of Rush, really. I think he's stirred up a lot of shit. I know he's driven my father's blood pressure up at least by 100 points. Fox News contributor Geraldo appeared Thursday on The Story with Martha McCullum, where he slammed conservative giant Rush Limbaugh. So now people are attacking their own. On his radio show, Limbaugh, now he's dying. Let's not forget that. Terminal lung cancer. He said that the country is trending towards secession. 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 Not succession. That's the show I like. Secession. Basically, you're a dying man and you want to stir up a civil war. Probably not the thing you want to do on your way out, I'd say. I think we're trending towards secession, Limbaugh said. I see more and more people asking, what in the world do we have in common with people who live in New York, he added. Okay, he lives in Florida. Do you know how many New Yorkers live in Florida? And he had a place for many, many years, I don't know, just because I read about it, in New York. So let's not act like you don't like New York. Same with Megyn Kellie. And all those people, they all have places in New York and they bebop around the restaurants and then they act like New York people are horrible. And that's bullshit. You're involved. It'd be one thing if you never lived there and said, I don't, I've never been there and it ain't my thing. Okay, well then you have a leg to stand on. I see more and more of them. There cannot be a peaceful coexistence of the two completely different theories in life. What do you think Southern Florida is? It's New Yorkers and then other people. That's where they go when they're done. And they don't want cold anymore.
Done.
You know, done with cold.
Flag.
Like, yeah, flag. I'm done. Theory. Different theories of life, theories of government, theories how we manage our affairs. We can't be in this dire conflict without something giving some way along the way. So I know there is a sizable and growing sentiment for the people who believe that this is where we were headed, whether we want to go there or not. Okay. You really want to start a civil war again? I talk about that in my act a lot. I am from Missouri, which with both. Confederate and Union, St. Louis Union, Southern Missouri Confederate. I've grown up in both. If we were going to have another civil war, I can tell you for sure I'm going with the North because I like a winner. Let's just take a few states. We'll just do some comparisons. Let's say we're going to start. I never understood the chutzpah of the Southerners back in the day of the real Civil War. They're a bunch of farmers, and they go, you know what? I got an idea. Let's attack New York City. Really? The place with all the money and the ammunition and the factories. You farmer guy. I mean, that took some balls. And I'm not saying any of the Southerners are like that now. I'm just saying this is what he's proposing. Let's take two Southern states. And we'll say you get to bet on this through DraftKings. Okay? Pennsylvania and Ohio versus Mississippi and Arkansas. Come on.
They got Walmart.
Walmart ain't enough. There's Walmarts in Ohio, I'm sure. Pennsylvania, probably. I'm just saying, let's just take two random northern states and put them up against two southern states.
What's the over-under?
Well, that would be on how many dead.
Okay.
Here's the spread.
Yeah.
I would have to give the South, like a football game points, 28.
Wow.
That's how badly they'd be beaten.
Okay.
Yeah. What else do we got? What else is down there? Mississippi.
Alabama.
Okay. Here's another matchup. The whole state of New York, mm-hmm. plus
Rhode Island.
No, it's too tiny. Okay, well, Rhode Island.
They're mighty.
Yeah, they're mighty. They're small. I have one friend from Rhode Island, comedian Jim McDonald. He said they're, you can take a picture of the whole state if you get high enough on a ladder. The whole state of New York and Rhode Island versus Alabama and South Carolina. I say you have to give
10.
10? No.
Rhode Island's got 9 people.
Yeah, but New York, you have the city and then the rest of New York. Everybody forgets about people that aren't from New York always think New York's just New York City.
I love Buffalo.
Buffalo's great.
Syracuse.
Oswego,
yeah.
Syracuse, mm-hmm. It just goes on and on and on.
Right.
Great places in New York. Anyway, this is, I mean, this is, it's just ridiculous, especially since people live all over. But Geraldo got mad. I think talk of secession is treason. I want to be very clear. Rush Limbaugh is a powerhouse broadcaster. He's one in a zillion. They came along once in a, but this talk is reckless and irresponsible. I agree. His wife, Geraldo's wife, Erica, is a Democrat. Went on to point out that although he backs Trump, his political views run on the spectrum of American politics. I live in Ohio. I did not know Geraldo lived in Ohio.
Do they like him there?
I don't know. Mm-hmm. I didn't even... Ohio, do you have an opinion? Where does he live in Ohio? Do any of you Ohioans know the answer to that? That seems different. I like Ohio, but I wouldn't think that... I like Columbus. I like Cincinnati. I like Cleveland. But I'm also pro-gun, pro-immigration reform, and I'm pro-choice.
He lives in Shaker Heights.
He lives in Shaker Heights in Cleveland?
Mm-hmm.
Huh. Leaders who accentuate the differences and exacerbate the divide are themselves responsible. Exactly. And that's what Rush Limbaugh has made a living doing, in my opinion. Dividing, and then stirring up. He's a shit stirrer upper. And, you know, never forget, Rush Limbaugh was unemployed in Missouri. His fat ass sat there and collected unemployment. And then he got a job doing what? He handed out souvenirs from the Kansas City Royals. I'm serious. That was his gig, PR department. And I did it for the St. Louis Blues, and it's a wonderful job. You're in charge of, like, you know, free stuff.
Not even a good team.
All right, termites. We've done so much today. It's been so much fun. I'm going to leave you, not with a mystery, a reminder, because it's super important. And I think by the time this one airs, by the time the next one airs, this will have already happened. So mark your calendars for the Christmas star. That's what they call it. The closest visible conjunction of Jupiter and Saturn in 800 years. When will that be? I've already told you, but I'm telling you again, because I forget shit. December 21st. You think I bought? Oh, I got to show you. I'll show you next week. I bought a $200 telescope on Amazon, and I put it together. I don't know that I did that correctly, because I really can't see anything. So I probably didn't. But I'm going to try and fix it, and then hope that it's clear enough to see the Christmas star. That's what they're called. Oh my God, that's the other thing. Shit, I don't know. On the winter solstice, which I believe is that also December 21st?
Yeah.
They're gonna live stream from Newgrange, which is in Ireland. And it's like Stonehenge. It's the same type of situation. It's this old, stone thing. But the engineering at that time was insane because the winter solstice comes right through this rock thing that was clearly built for that. So they knew all that back then and then somehow structured this thing like scientifically perfectly. But they're gonna live stream. You'd have to Google it. I don't know where. Online, you can see the winter solstice at Newgrange online, which I don't know that they've ever done before. And people go there for that, but boy, do you have to have a reservation like 50 years in advance. And I would say it's impossible, but maybe for real Irish people, they can get in. But for tourists like us, probably I'm gonna say nay-nay, like John Panette would say nay-nay on that. Very difficult. Maybe if you know somebody, I don't know. Damn it, I printed out something about Newgrange to tell you guys, but I guess I lost it. Well, the show notes, yeah, but it was pretty interesting to read. Anywho, I'll save the rest of this for next time. Zodiac killer. Hint. And is that all I really had to tell you that was super important? Yes, I think so. So, don't forget, December 21st. I'm trying to talk my parents into being on the Pubcast, but more importantly, I have to think of what to ask them to get the most out of them, if you know what I mean. So that's it, termites. I'm halfway through my Bloody Mary. Still have my beer back from Old Smoky Moonshine glass. And
Christmas is coming.
What? Christmas is coming. It's very exciting. Go look at a picture of my brother's front yard on my Instagram or my Twitter. We usually have a competition, but I can't do this alone on a ladder as much as he can because I don't want to go to a hospital if I fall off said ladder. I'm trying to be a little more careful. He's totally kicked my ass. I've laid down arms. He has won. That's it, really. That's all I got. I'm going to try to get the old people on here. I'm going to give these to my mom. She'll love them. I'm going to eat the Rice Krispies, and that's it. Oh, wait, subscribe on the YouTube channel. Tell your friends, because that's the only way I can get to be with you guys. But this, if you hit subscribe, I sound like a 12-year-old. Please subscribe to my channel. it helps the YouTube people. Will then, if I have a lot of subscribers, then they'll just tell people to go to videos, which is great. That works out good, because I can't be yelling about that every week.
Go here, go there.
It's exhausting. And Pubcast t-shirts available. I have mine. I have to wash it like twice though because I'm always allergic to whatever's in t-shirts. I have very big ones for the chubby termites. Don't let me down, chubbies. I bought 2 times, 3 times. Because a lot of people want that size and it's more expensive and I'm eating the cost on your behalf. I am. That's bullshit too. How much more material is it? You know, whatever. Okay. That's it. I haven't got my flannel sheets yet, but I'm gonna. At least one. I'm gonna try one. And maybe a top sheet that's not flannel. And because a lot of you termites really like yours. That's it. I'm gonna say pull up your sheets, tuck yourself in, and what?